picture only to indicate that the distance, when I talk about the distance between the two sets, then one has to take, of course, the Hermitian symmetry into account. So this picture that I drew is actually cheating because you have the Hermitian symmetry, so this matrix element, the this matrix elements are the same. So you have to do it in such a way that you have to introduce a distance modulo this Hermitian symmetry. So here's a good illustration of that.
What do you have a condition on this? That's simply on the point correlation, WIJWKL.
Yes, that describes the whole thing, but we need the stronger condition. This is for any function. So one could fight on that, yes. One could fight on that whether the usual polynomial function. You mean that why I don't do it only for polynomials? It's easier in this way. So okay. So and now let me just mention the usual corollaries of the local law. So these are the delocalization of the bulk eigenvectors, the rigidity of the bulk eigenvectors, and the universality in the bulk. So let me just flash them through. These are all very natural corollaries. The delocalization of the eigenvalues means that if you take an eigenvector, the delocalization of eigenvectors means if you take an eigenvector, so you take a vector u, which solves the eigenvector equation, eigenvector equation, for an eigenvalue which is in the bulk, then you will know that the L, and it's a normalized L2 normalized eigenvector, then you know that the maximum of the eigenvector is essentially 1 over square root of n. The 1 over square root of n means that you have a vector of length n, it's a normalized vector, L2 normalized vector, and the typical size of each matrix, and if all the matrix, all the vector components are roughly the same, then each of them is a order 1 over square root of n. And it tells you that in the delocalization, tells you that in the strongest possible sense, the L infinity norm is bounded by this 1 over square root of n. And this you can actually very easily get once you have a control on the diagonal element of the resolvent. So to control that, to get such an information, it's already not sufficient to get an information on the trace of the resolvent, you need to get the diagonal matrix element. Now, the rigidity is a similar type of statement. The rigidity tells you where roughly the random eigenvalue lies, and here, and the precise formulation that important, it tells you that every eigenvalue have a natural location. If you take an eigenvalue, say, take an eigenvalue with a certain label, say lambda I, this is not the way how it's formulated, but I explain it in a way which is easier to understand. You take the eigenvalue lambda I, where should that be? Now, if the eigenvalues follow exactly a semicircle law, or in more general, it did follow its own density law, then the lambda I should be at the ith quantile of the corresponding distribution. And this formula here, written in a somewhat different way, it tells you that the true eigenvalue is not much farther away than the corresponding quantile, and not much far means that the distance essentially 1 over n, maybe a little bit n to the epsilon. Okay, so here's a picture, that's probably what Gerard asked. So this is a picture of a nice, far from being semicircle situation, and then you still have the bulk universality after you discuss things properly. Okay, so I think that's where I should stop.
This matrix is there a simple mapping between that and the shape of the...
Yes, yeah, I mean, there's a mapping, it's not a simple mapping. This is the Dyson equation, this I will discuss next time. So we will have an equation, non-trivial coupled non-linear system of equations, which involve the S. Can write it up. So this kind of equation, minus 1 over M I Z plus S M I, where M is this matrix. This will be our fundamental equation. And you have to solve this equation for all M I, and then the density is basically the average. This will be the average of the MI will be the Stierkast transform of that density. So that's the way to, that's the connection between that. So there is no simple formula, but there is an explicit deterministic procedure.
Thank you.
So you said that those singularities were the only types you could get, right?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So it seems like if you so if you collide two of the square singularities, you get a cusp.
Yes.
What mm-hmm. happens if you collide two cusps?
That doesn't happen.
By getting a small thing and
That doesn't happen.
Is that impossible to
imagine? Yes, I think this is impossible. It's anyway, what we prove is that there is only so once you have a cusp. Here's a cusp. Once you have a cusp, then we know that in the neighborhood of that cusp, so once you have a cusp, then it means that the neighborhood of the cusp is behaves like e to the 1/3.
So I mean, like, between the cusps are sort of semicircle-like objects. So imagine you could just shrink that thing down.
Yeah, but you know, you cannot really do freely what you want to do. This picture is governed by what you can do on the level of this. So I mean, what you try to say is that you want to say something like that, I think. And then you want me to, so there is an S matrix, there are some parameters in the S. So S is some S of T, for example. And you want me to create a flow of STs so that this one shrinks. This doesn't happen. So what we do is that we describe that whenever you have a cusp, then it behaves like x to the 1/3 in a definite neighborhood of that cusp.